brought to you by
Eaton Detroit Spring, proudly made in the USA.
Classic car or muscle car? We want to show you how to restore your automobile and save yourself some money in the process. Sometimes we consult the pros, sometimes we mess up. But just remember, it's never a problem, it's always a project.
Right now on Auto Restomod, Jeff and Cam show how to change the carrier style differential on a Ford Mustang.
I've never had one do that before.
Honey, what are you doing out there?
Waiting on the next Super Blowout 3-Day Only Mega Sale.
You don't need a sale. You need NPD.
NPD's everyday prices are competitive with most sales, and orders arrive fast from our four strategically located superstores. National Parts Depot has quality parts for Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, GTO, Firebird, Ford, and Chevy truck. For your free catalog, go online or call toll-free.
Working beats waiting.
It's a lightweight wheel, but it ain't real light. Okay, real fast. This week what we're gonna be doing is we're gonna be working on the 9-inch rear axle on our 67 Mustang Fastback. And in doing that, I wanted to go over a couple of things about safety. Now, when you're working on a car like this, you'll wanna make sure you chalk the front tires. You'll also wanna make sure that you put your jack stands either on the axles or put it on the backing plates underneath the car. And you wanna get the thing up as high as you can just to make it a little easier on you to work on it. You have to remember, these 9-inch center sections are pretty darn heavy. So now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go over some of the stuff that we ran across in coming to the decision to show this week, because honestly, I really wasn't gonna do that. Just wasn't in the mood. And now, so what I wanted to do is kind of go over what we've got here on the floor. Because the 9-inch is so stinking heavy, I'm not gonna try putting this up on our tables. You can end up crashing a table with both of these on here. What I've got here are a 9-inch with an Eaton Detroit TruTrack in it and a 9-inch with a Ford standard traction lock in it. This is a 350 axle. This is a 370 axle. This is the one we built with Alan Shepley a little while back. If you want to see the build out on how to do a 9-inch like the one we've got, go out and check out the URL that we've got placed down here in the bottom. Now, one of the first things that we're going to talk about is lubrication on these axles. There's a difference between the type of system that the Eaton uses and the system that Ford uses. Ford uses a clutch system and Eaton uses a conical interference type system. So you're going to have to be particular about your gear oils in these systems. Now, what you're going to want to use is a standard GL5 lubrication system on the Eaton Detroit TruTrack. You want to lube that has absolutely no friction modifiers in it if you can get away with it at all. Because of the way the system is set up, it doesn't like friction modifiers. And if you read your Eaton Detroit TruTrack information, which, you know, a lot of us don't, you will notice that it says do not use friction modifiers in the rear axle. The Ford, on the other hand, will use a friction modifier in the lube, and you can actually now get lubrication with the friction modifier already built in. Ford 9-inch is going to take about 3 quarts of lube, and we'll go into that a little bit later on. Some of the things I want to go over with you right now is when you're painting these things up. Now, Ford typically did these in a red iron oxide. This is a little bit dark, but it's also Rust-Oleum. So I like the Rust-Oleum paint because it keeps it from rusting. This is just a red that really kind of matches the original color fairly well. And what I do a lot of times with these is, because this is such a complicated piece here, I'll paint the yoke assembly first, and then I'll paint the axle assembly after I use some aluminum foil and tape to tape off the pinion cover and the actual pinion itself. I'll take this off, and I'm going to dismantle my taping here. Another nice thing I want to talk about while I'm doing this is how I've got these things set up. Now, you can buy cans at places like Summit and that you can put 9-inch rear axles in. What I've done here is I've used a couple of small 2-gallon buckets from the Home Improvement Center to hold these, and they've been in there a pretty good while, so I feel pretty confident that these are going to hold up if you use them. The nice thing about it is when you're putting this together with these buckets, you can actually use them to paint things, because your axle is completely encased inside the bucket. If you'll see here, it's just sitting here. All the gearing, everything inside of here is actually down inside the bucket. So if you get paint even on the back side of the casing, you're not going to hurt anything. I actually made my own axle tag for this axle. because we are running an Eaton True Track in here, I wanted to make sure that if somebody ever got into this thing down the road, that they knew it was an Eaton True Track and it had a 370 year set in it. Yes, and you can get stamps for that down at places like the tool companies that you see around the United States now will carry letter sets that are stamping sets. Another thing I'm gonna talk about right now, and we'll show you a little bit later on too, is find yourself some of these 2634s copper washers. The Ford 9-inch and 8-inch require copper washers in order to seal correctly. You cannot get these at Ford anymore. They have been discontinued. National Parts Depot carries them, and you can find them occasionally on eBay. We got these from our friend Bob Oswald, Oswald's Classic Mustang. He actually had some there in the shop. We forgot to order them from NPD, so we had to go get these from Bob, and basically, you know, we're just going to probably end up costing us something down the road. Other than that, you're going to see I've got some Play-Doh down here on the floor. Now the Play-Doh is actually for going in and checking some things that I'm going to talk about here in just a second when I pull all this lube and stuff out of the way. I need to get a couple things. I'm going to come back and talk about pinion depth. All right, so we're going to be talking about some of the differences in the 9-inch center sections on these cars. Now Ford had a number of different yoke depths on these. Basically, typically, your pinion mount, this area here on these, is pretty universal across the board. These are going to be about the same depth. You are going to have some differences with snubber pieces like this. This snubber is for an early car. Some of the later cars had a larger steel snubber. This one, the snubber's on the body. Some of them, the snubber was on the 9-inch center section. Not really as important as what I'm fixing to talk about, which is actually the yoke depth itself. So what you want to do is just typically what I've done in the past is you'll take a mobile L like this one that I have here, and you'll go in and use this to check your depth on the pinion. Now you'll notice that we have an immediate problem. We're a much deeper set here. We're probably a good inch away from the actual support here, and that's not good because your drive shaft is going to be affected by this depth. Now the nice thing is, in talking to Alan Shepley at Mustang Central the other night about this, we ran into this setting this all up. Alan said that the yoke can be taken off these and changed out. In other words, this yoke can be changed out for this yoke. And that's really it for this part of it. Now the other thing I do is, the other thing that can be changed on here too is the universal joints can be different on these cars. Some of them have a larger universal joint. There's one guys like a little bit better for high performance applications. This is not a super high performance car. We're not going drag racing with this thing. It's never our intent with a car. It's basically a street car. So what you'll do, what I do, is I'll go in and use Play-Doh to establish what I've got for the universal joints that are actually on the car, and then use this to put to the new axle that's going in there. That way I can take in with this flattened out because you've got the universal joint in this position. Just slide this up on here, and if I get a good fit with the Play-Doh, I know that I've got the same universal joint size on the axle going in as I have on the axle underneath the car already. Just something to save yourself a little bit of time. If the car is a mobile car, with this, you'll know what you need to do. Stupid little stuff like that can go into making your day a lot shorter in the long haul. So now what we're going to do is we're going to talk about pulling the axles on these cars, because there's some things you can run into if the axles have been in there for a good while. Play-Doh. All right. First thing I'm going to do here is I'm going to take the drum off. Now, if this was a factory original drum, you may would have little keepers on here to keep the drum in place. That's not going to be the case on 99% of this, but I wanted to make that point. You're going to need to pull the drum off. Oh, there we go. Hey, the brakes are working. The drum over here. Now, when you're taking a 9-inch out or putting one in, there are bolts on the back side back here, and there's a hole in the actual axle face that you take and roll around to the position to take the nuts off. You've got a nut in there. And you've got four of these, and these can actually be taken off without taking the brakes apart on a Ford. And then the fun can begin, because sometimes you won't be able to get the axle to come out. And I've got a little tip for that as well. Okay, now there's two ways to take the axles out. If the axle assembly is fairly new on here, you're probably just going to be able to bump it and pull it out. If you have a problem pulling the axle out, you can actually take the brake drum, put the brake drum back on backwards, and use it as a puller. You put a couple of your nuts on here, and then you can use this as a puller to bang that axle out. I'm gonna put a couple of these back on here. You only thread them in a little bit, but now we've got this on here. We can take the drum and go like that and pop the axle out of the assembly. Take the drum back off. Now, I don't like leaving the axle hanging. Some guys will do that, but there's actually a seal inside the axle that you don't want to have get bent out of shape if this thing's gonna hang here for a little bit. Okay, now what I'm gonna show you right here is basically when you're pulling something like this apart, if you're putting a 9-inch in a car, then you don't know the condition of your axle assemblies. Check your axles out, make sure your bearings are in good shape. These are brand new bearings. They're looking a little rusty kinda, but they're really not. It's just basically from this car sitting around for a little while. But the bearings feel real nice. There's no crunchiness to them. If these are crunchy at all, you're going to need to go in and replace your bearings. And this is something you have to have done at a shop. These have to be pressed on. You can actually get these through National Parts Depot, Summit. A lot of places carry the axle bearings. Now I'm going to take this off, and we're going to pull the axle completely out and set it aside so that we can get busy on the rest of it. Okay, now, sometimes you can run into problems with the universal joints on these cars not wanting the clamp here not wanting to come out. I've run into that on this car, so of course it's a good thing for me to show you. Now normally I would try to do something like this with a brass hammer. I do not have one. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this claw hammer I've got right here and just use my claw to tap this out till we get it to a point. Now that one just popped loose, so that should be good to go. And now I'm going to roll it over. I'm going to put pressure this way on my drive shaft so that it doesn't fall out on my face, because I don't really want to wear a drive shaft today. And I'm going to tap these till I got enough room. I don't like using a steel hammer on a steel fastener like this, because you can sometimes mushroom the head. I don't think that's going to be an issue here though. Okay, we're loose now. And I should be able to pull the drive shaft forward and get this one to drop out. All right, Cam has said that he'd rather leave the drive shaft in here, so I'm gonna actually go in and do something to save me from trying to find a million little needle bearings. I'm gonna take some tape. I'm gonna tape the drive shaft, or the universal joint, to the drive shaft. I'm using electrical tape because it's just nice and stretchy. There we go. I'm surprised I didn't drop the drive shaft on my forehead yet. That's usually the thing I do. I'm gonna slide that out of the way, and now Cam should have enough room to get in here and do what he needs to do. Bye.
All right, well, since Jeff is a pansy and doesn't like gear oil, I'm under here. So pretty easy, just take a wrench, and these are obviously not torqued. So when you buy a vehicle that's been partially assembled, make sure to check stuff like this, because that's not good. But just break them loose. You can usually pull them off by hand. If you can't, just keep a ratchet on it. All right. Also, ratcheting wrench. Very helpful when under here. Got some tight spaces. You can get under there. Much easier. All right. Now, if you see here, we got copper washers. Those are supposed to be there. So if they're not there, that is bad. And you need to replace them whenever you pull the chunk out. Once you get to the top bolts on the chunk, you want to use a 3/8 ratchet with a couple extensions and a universal joint. It really helps to get to the hard to reach bolts because you can put a little bit of angle on the universal joint. And we also have a flex head ratchet just so you can get around parts that, you know, the yoke, exhaust mufflers, all that kind of stuff. But let's keep going to town busting nuts off. That was really bad. So we ran into the problem of these little copper washers here holding pressure on the studs to keep it from leaking, which it is supposed to do that. So what we're doing is we have a chisel and a hammer. Take chisel on one side, and just kind of walk it up. You gotta walk it off the stud. Just go from side to side, and just keep working it. All right, so once you get these bent up a little bit, you can sometimes spin them by hand off, or you could use a set of standard pliers, really, and you just grab them. Give it the old lefty-loosey, righty-tighty. All right, so I got it loose, and as you can see, spin it off by hand, and bye-bye. All right, so what we're going to do is we're going to take a chisel and a hammer, put it in between the axle housing and the carrier, and try and split the carrier off the housing. All right, so couldn't get it with the little guy, so we went meow meow, and yeah.
Meow meow?
Yeah. You know, from the movie?
Oh, yeah. The problem we're running into is we left the copper washers on the top three studs up there because we wanted to be a little lazy. It's not going to let us be lazy. We're going to have to actually go in and go in and try to knock those copper washers loose.
All right, now what we had to do is we had to drop the axle a little bit. So we jacked the car up on the frame rails on either side, and then I grabbed a pair of vice grips. Oddly enough, you can use vice grips to do this and get on the flange of that copper washer and try to spin it off of the axle itself. And this is a process that's going to take some time. I'm not kidding you. You'll be here a while doing this because it's not the easiest thing to get it to do, especially up in where we're at right now. I don't know if it'll spin off like a nut at this point. Yeah, here we go. Anyway, so use a pair of vice grips to get the top three out of here is the best way to do it, but you will have to drop the axle down. So we're going to do that, and then we'll come back and take the axle out of it in a minute.
We have all the copper washers out, so you'll take these two nuts that we put on loose. You should be able to slide this forward. Yeah, there we go. Beautiful. Now just let it drain until it's done. Alright, so we've let this drain out for a little bit, and as you can see, it's pretty much done dripping, so we're going to go ahead and yank it. Need to be careful. This thing is way heavier than it looks, but I do this pretty often. So it's just going to be about getting the angles right. And sliding off the studs. Pulling her down and out. Yeah.
It's dripping.
Oh, glad I don't have to clean this jacket. And now...
Thank you, Kenworth.
All right, now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to take this, put it over the axle. And now we got a place to store it. And it won't leak. All right, clean up the mess, Cam. Look at the mess you made.
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
Jeez.
So what I'm doing here is just scooping out the axle housing oil because we have an Eaton TrueTrack in the new chunk, and that does not require a friction modifier. We don't know if this oil has friction modifier in it, but so we're taking precautions, cleaning it out so we don't mess up the new chunk.
All right, I'm going to have Cam push this thing. I'm going to use a jack to try to get this thing up into position because the 9-inch is incredibly heavy. The center section is anyway. All right, that's good enough, Cam. All right, start jacking this thing up a little bit. No easy way to do this, as far as I can tell, except just do it. It's a lot easier to do this if you've got a lift. A couple more weeks, we should be there. Yes, the ring gear has to go over the top of it. I don't know what happened. It actually went on like it's supposed to. All right, Cam, go ahead and take the jack out of it. That's really weird. I've never had one do that before. Yay, team! And we're going to tighten these things up to, reference material says 25 to 40 foot-pounds. I would tend to go with the 40 foot-pounds. I don't know, maybe even hit it in the middle and do 35, but you're going to want to tighten it up to that, and then you should be good to go. All right, get these on, put our nuts on here, get her back out on the street. All right, a couple things to go over before we close this bad boy out. Now, I wanted to go over some things on your carriers on the Ford 8 and 9-inch axles. 1965 on back probably won't have this fill port on the side of them. They typically filled through the actual housing itself. They didn't fill on the carrier. That's really important if you go to buy an axle and a housing that are separate from each other. So you may buy an axle center section and then you buy a housing to go on the car. You want to make sure that you have a fill port somewhere, because if you put a newer housing with an early center section, you really won't have any way to put any fluid in or know what your fluid level is unless you find a way to put a hole in it somewhere or put your stuff in through the actual housing like we have right here. And we're going to talk about that in just a second. Now, filling up your 9-inch or 8-inch, you're going to put about 2 to 3 quarts of lube inside of it. On the later model carrier center sections, you have a fill here. You want to put your fluid to just at the bottom of that port. You'll be able to stick your finger down in there to know how much fluid you've got in it. Now, I'll say this. Trying to put enough fluid in this center section on a 60-0 Mustang, horrible to try to do underneath the car through this port. The port's kind of small. I've had problems with the tube popping out. I'm sure there are easy ways to do it, but if you're just a home guy like we are around here, you're not going to be able to do it very easily. So what I recommend is this. You'll want to go in and get yourself some 3/8 inch fuel line like I've got right here, and you'll use that fuel line to go in and put your fluid in. Now, what I want you to do, though, is take that axle and actually tilt that axle down so that the fluid quickly runs into the center section. You'll then want to level it back up, do a check, and at that point, you can start adding smaller increments in by the fill port on the side of the axle rather than trying to get 2 quarts in there. A lot easier to go in through the axle housing assembly. The last thing I'm going to talk about on here are our nuts that we have on. Now, these nuts typically torque to 20 to 40 foot-pounds of torque. You want to hit them with a torque wrench. A lot of times, guys like me really don't necessarily worry about a torque wrench because you'll be okay with it. And that's really the last thing I'm going to talk about on this. We're not going to really be able to go out and do a driving sequence with this, only because we're going to run into a little bit of a problem of time. We're in the holiday season when we're filming this, and basically we're shooting this last part of this on a Sunday right before Christmas. So we probably won't be able to show it doing a two-tire fire with the Eaton Detroit TruTrack on it. But in any case, do us a favor and come back and watch us next time on Auto Restomod. We air every Thursday on YouTube. We have all of our videos available on our website as well as on our YouTube channel. So check us out in both of those locations and come back and watch us every week on Auto Restomod. Have a great, happy new year, everyone.